It has been my privilege in the last 2 years or so to know Naren and Bharti very closely, because the quality of work that they do with one of the institutions called Social Venture Partners that I'm part of has been absolutely inspirational. But thank you for inviting me today, because I think this whole concept of the brain tattoo is tattooed in my head. And the first brain tattoo I got, which is actually the first comment that somebody made, was this whole concept of adding value. And Naren asked me to speak for 15 minutes, which I'm normally a trainer and not a speaker, but I will try and give you some instances. I was also asked to talk about my life, which is, I mean, when I tell you the story of my life, you will say, bas kya, yehi kya, I can also become that. I mean, all the hype you get about what Naren said is not true at all. But I will try and accomplish those things. But let me start by opening it up and saying that, look, when you talk about adding value, let me give you one example. When I was 33 years old, I became the CEO of this company called Aptech. Aptech was this computer training company. And I was privileged, I think it was 1993, 2 years after I became CEO of Aptech, to meet a person called Devang Mehta. I know many of you have heard of Devang Mehta. Devang Mehta is, I mean, when I was 35, he was probably the same age, 35. And he had just taken on the responsibility of building an institution called NASSCOM. NASSCOM is the National Association of Software Companies. 1994, we were a little less than $200 million association. And Devang was a young man who was told, make it happen for India, guys. Because if you remember in the 90s, when you talked about India, people remembered the sadhu and the rope trick and everything else. But nobody associated India with leadership. And Devang was one person who said that, look, at least in one industry, let's make leadership happen. I mean, today, as many of you may know, India has 55% market share in the software outsourcing business, which is absolutely amazing, because there's no other country in no industry which has achieved that kind of growth in 25, 26 years. It's absolutely amazing. But the point I'm making is, how does this value get added? I'll give you one example and then I'll move to a more general idea. Devang used to have this wonderful story, and I used to go around the world with Devang Mehta, just talking about the power of Indian youth, the power of the Indian IT professional, etc., etc. And I still remember, and this story I'll never forget, we were talking in Dubai one day to a group of Arab sheikhs and very senior leaders. And Devang asked the question, saying that, look, you all heard of the Indian IT software industry. Do you know to which country the first exports ever happened? Do you know? Any answer? America? No? The logical answer to this is Devang, whichever country he went, he would say that country. Keep him happy. So he said, of course it was Dubai. So people said, oh my God, the first software thing happened in Dubai. He said, yes, and let me give you an example of how it happened. So he gave the story of this very rich Arab sheikh in Dubai, in the desert. And very rich, what is the richness of an Arab sheikh measured in? Don't tell me dirhams. What does he own? Camels, absolutely. Oil is one, oil is just an input. Ultimately, what they really like is not having four wives, and that is a byproduct, but having as many camels as possible. So Devang used to say that, look, there was a very rich Arab sheikh who one day dies, and then all the Bedouins in the desert, they cluster around and say, okay, we have to distribute his wealth amongst his children. He has three sons, the sheikh. And then they round up the camels and they find he has 17 camels. And then they say, now how do we distribute? Then somebody says, no. He told me 2 years back that he's made a will. So they find the will of the Arab sheikh. And the will says, when I die, half my camels will go to the first son. 1/3 of my camels will go to the second son. And 1/9 of my camels will go to the third son. Sounds easy. I mean, even if you're from Dubai, that much math is possible. So they take 17 and they say half. 1/3, impossible. 1/9, not possible. And one thing you do not do if you're from the Middle East, you don't cut camels and say, I will give 1.5. It's not allowed. So they say, now what do we do? So then they say, no, we've heard of this company called Tata Consultancy Services. And they have this office in Jangli Maharaj Road in Pune. Let us ask them to help us. And this is before email and WhatsApp and everything else. So what they do is they send a fax to TCS in Pune. And they get a fax back after one day saying, don't worry, we will send a bright young software engineer called Arun Patil, and he will come and solve the problem. So they're all waiting there. After 3 days, they find one software engineer who's coming along the desert riding his camel. And Mr. Patil comes and says, okay, I've come from Tata Consulting Services. Can you tell me what your problem is? They tell him there's a very complex mathematical problem. He says, that is a problem? Just keep my camel. Suddenly 17 camels become 18 camels. The first son gets half, which is 9 camels. The second son gets a third, which is 6 camels. The third son gets 1/9, which is 2 camels. 9 plus 6, 15 plus 2, 17. They say, we have one camel left. And Patil says, that is my camel. And he goes back. Why am I telling you this stupid story on a Sunday morning? Because adding value is in the mind. If we believe we will add value, and I 100% agree with everything that Naren just said, if we have the self-belief that we can add value, we do not need the power of resources, the power of title, the power of heredity. My father, my grandfather was this great man, and hence I will be a great man. Nothing like that. Each one of us in this room can add value to the company. And believe me, ladies and gentlemen, the $150 billion industry that today is called IT and business services from India was built by people like you and me with intelligence, with innovation, with an idea saying we can add value. And we don't need oil fields and we don't need anything to them. And see, that's the point. Let me give you my own story. I grew up in one of the most significant states in India. It's called Bihar. Everybody laughs about it. I grew up in this little city called Ranchi, which till 15 years back, I used to say Ranchi, people say, ye kya hota hai? Then Mahendra Singh Dhoni happened, and today everybody knows what Ranchi is. By the way, our commissioner, who is my hero in this city, Kunal Kumar, he's also from Ranchi. So we have a bunch of Ranchiites trying to change Pune, which is will not be good news, but that's a different story. And where I grew up was actually not even in Ranchi. It was a little village called Tatisilva. You can Google it, you'll find it's true. And Tatisilva was about 10 kilometers outside Ranchi. Why was I growing up there? Because my father, who actually grew up as a very poor boy in Tamil Nadu, moved to Ranchi to set up a chemicals factory along with two friends of his. And he was running the factory. And it was a very small factory. My father has always been my inspiration. And I won't get there because I can talk for 3 hours about my father. But he was one person who literally added value in multiple directions. Cultural dimensions, religious dimensions, quality of work, social service, etc., etc. But we were growing up there, and the nearest school was about 6 kilometers away. We didn't have chauffeur-driven cars in those days. So my sister and I would bicycle every morning to the school and come back. And I still remember when we used to come back home at 2:30 in the afternoon, the first thing we did was throw our school bags, and my father was running this little Seva Kendra for the Ramakrishna Mission, which used to bring all the village kids together, I mean, very similar to what Naren does and what you are going to do. And we, for 2 hours every afternoon, from Monday to Sunday, no holidays, we'll sing songs, okay, we will talk, and we will hopefully add value to each other. And this is the way I grew up in my life. At that point of time, my best friend was the son of my father's, one of the security guards. And his name was Fantush. His name is really Fantush. People think I joke when I talk about him. And Fantush was my best friend. So almost for 10 years, all we did was, you know, run around the villages together, etc. That's how I grew up. And in those days, I used to get very inspired, and all of us have inspirational stories. Most of you would have read a story called Jack and the Beanstalk, right? I mean, this boy Jack suddenly sees, looks outside his window, and he sees a big beanstalk growing, and then climbs up the beanstalk, etc., etc. And I always used to believe that even growing up in Tatisilva, in Ranchi, with a friend called Fantush, there must be something I can achieve in my life. This was going to be very easy for me otherwise just to stay there. And when I got a chance, after doing my engineering in BIT Mesra in Ranchi, and somebody said that, look, here's a chance for you to go to study in Bombay. I said, let me do that. Everything was opportunity. Started working in Nasik in a company called Crompton Graves. And I think if there's one thing I've learned during those times, including the chance opportunity to meet people like Devang Mehta, is that as you move along in life, you have to look for opportunities everywhere. This chance to run this company called Aptech happened when I was, as I said, 33 years old. I was sitting in Delhi. I was working with this company, NIIT. And I get a call on a Sunday morning, very similar to this, 8:30 in the morning. Some headhunter saying that, look, we are looking for a managing director for this company, Aptech. Would you like to be considered? I said, no, 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 I'm not even ready. I'm only 33 years old. I'll give you the phone number of my boss, because I was hoping he would take my boss away so that I could have a better life. but he said, no, 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 we want to talk to you. I said, if some fool wants to make me managing director at the age of 33, why should I have to? And sure enough, I went and met Mr. Atul Nishad, who is the guy who had set it up. And we had started talking, and he said, look, I mean, you think you can do it. You seem to have the confidence. You speak well. I said, great. If that is what is required to be managing director, I'm on. So I moved to Bombay. And I still remember in those days, the computer training was a very small industry. I mean, today, of course, every street corner, you will see computer training. But I remember going to that company, and there were about 200 people employed in Aptech. We were running 7 training centers. 4 of them were in Bombay, so it was really a Mumbai-centric kind of shop. And in those days, and even today, being a computer trainer was not aspirational. The software industry was just starting. There was TCS and Infosys, etc. And everybody, after about 6 months of maybe teaching something, would suddenly want to move on and do something else. And when we calculated what is called attrition, which is the number of people leaving, we found that the attrition in the company was close to 170%. Which means that if you started the year with 200 people, you probably lost 240 people during the year. And that's the level of... So we said, oh my God, how do we solve this problem? So I still remember we got these 200 people together and said, guys, what do you want to pick up? And we said, look, we are now 7 training centers. So we built this big vision for us, saying by the year 2000, turn of the century, we should be at least 100 training centers. We should be at least one country outside India so that we also believe that we are doing, you know, kind of exports of foreign work. So we said, great. When I left Aptech in 2001, we were 1,200 training centers in 42 countries. And how did this happen? It happened not because I sat and saying, I'm the managing director, we should do it. Because if I had said that, we would have been 100 training centers and one country as well. But it is purely the power of energy of young people. And I was telling Prashant, who was kind enough to pick me up from home and drag me here, that is one thing I've learned. You know, you just create an opportunity, like all of you will do, I'm sure, next week onwards in the classes you're going to teach. You open up the windows of opportunity for people. And believe me, they will perform, they will deliver, they will add value much better than you can imagine, because the power of young people to dream big dreams is much more today than maybe when you were. So the first message I'd like to give you is, don't limit your own class by the power of your imagination. Just open up the windows, open up the doors, and let them imagine. Same thing happened in Zensar. I mean, when I came here in 2001, Zensar was a really, really small company. I mean, we had 400 people. This was just post what is called the economic slowdown. This was 6 months before Osama bin Laden was going to change the world. We didn't know that. And I still remember I was talking to my board and said, look, I mean, why have you hired me to run a 400 people, chota company, 40 crores of revenue? And they said, look, you have two choices. I mean, either you understand what the company is doing, recommend to us that we shut it down, we're willing to shut it down. And I said, what happens to my job? But I didn't ask them that. Or tell us what you want to do. Again, we did the same thing. We formed this vision community. We had this, I still remember, we had this very, very bright young woman who had just joined from the defense labs. Her previous boss was Abdul Kalam. Then she comes here and I become her boss. And I told her, I said, her name is Pramila. She's today the executive vice president and location head of Zensar in Pune. I told Pramila, look, you get a bunch of guys together and you create what you want this company to become. And even then, we were a small company, as I said, 400 people. They came up with some specific things. They said, look, they're a proud company. We only want to work with large Fortune 500 companies. We actually made a list. Said, look, which are the 10 companies we want to be the supplier partners? So we said, Cisco, we said, Marks & Spencer, Credit Suisse, etc. Again, at the end of 5-6 years, we were 90% of our business was coming from Fortune 500. Fortunately, we didn't set any revenue goals, because for a 40 crore company, if you had said, what do we want to become in 15 years, we'd have probably said maybe 10 times, you know, 400 crores, 800 crores, 1,000 crores. I mean, when I left Zensar in the end of April, we were all of 3,000 crores, 8,000 people, and there's no limits for that. So I'm giving you corporate examples because the power of youth, and I have understood one mantra throughout my life, and I'll explain this to you and then I'll kind of come to the end of what I'm saying. that when you add value, I've already said that, look, you give some ideas and get out of the way. The second thing I learned, and this is my mantra, in fact, my new company is called 5F World. And a lot of people say, what the heck is 5F? 5F is the mantra I learned in Aptiq, which I'm learning in Zensar, which I've learned everywhere in this on this planet. And the 5Fs are very simple. The first F is fast. Naren rightly said that. You have to keep improvising, you have to keep making those small changes to make sure that you are faster than the next person. The second is focus. Unfortunately, in this country today, there is so much of opportunities for distraction, especially for young people, that they've stopped reading. They've stopped thinking about positive things about the future. All we see is 9 o'clock, we see Arnab Goswami on Times Now, cursing everybody on the planet, and we say, oh, everything must be bad in this country. But we don't go around and visit life school and meet people like Narendra and say that, look, there are good things possible. So that is the focus on what you really want to achieve in your life, and hopefully what you want other people to achieve, so that you can make some effort at training or educating them. The third F, which I'm very fond of, is flexible. Now, sometimes, especially when we have these dogmatic views on life, we decide too early in life, ki mujhe bas yehi karna aur kuch nahi karna. So even the opportunities that life throws at you occasionally, you have the windows of your mind are not open, so you're not able to absorb those opportunities. I mean, if you look at my own career, started off in manufacturing, set up my startup when I was 25 years old, sold off that startup, joined an IIT, then Aptiq 10 years, 15 years Zensar, and now we're doing this completely new startup which is just investing in young people, their imagination, their companies, etc. So I've been through maybe 7 career changes by just saying that, look, what is my strength? My strength is enabling people to think fast, be focused, be flexible in terms of opportunity, and most important, our last two apps, friendly and fun. For me, that is the most important, because if people stop having fun, as Naren rightly said, if people don't smile all the time, what are we doing? Are we making the planet a better place by being stressful, by being tough all the time? Or are we being, as you read, the golden touch, are we being friendly to people, making them smile, making them happy, even if it's for a few minutes? Today what I do, which I think Naren would have told some of you, apart from building this business called 5F World, we run this entity called Social Venture Partners. Social Venture Partners is a group of 40 people, okay, including Naren, Bharti, me, my wife, and about 20 other partners, including people like Mayor Padamji and Kumar Gera, and many of the big names in the city. So we really are an integrated body of people who say we will do good work for society. So Naren himself, for instance, has adopted this entity called Jagruti Sansa. And Jagruti builds young women, okay, who do not have a future, maybe in the slum dwellers or people who got married, came back from their husbands, and gives them the opportunity to become nursing assistants. When we first discovered Jagruti and their little center behind Senapati Bapat Road, it was just one small center. Today, thanks to the outstanding work done by Naren, Bharati, and quite a few of us, there are multiple centers. Yesterday, when Prime Minister was here in Pune, one of the main things he launched was what we call the Pune Lighthouse Program. And what we were showing him was actually the Jagruti Sansthan, and saying how through new technology, we will enable Jagruti Sansthan to scale to maybe not 50 people per year, but maybe 10,000 people per year. So that is the scale that is possible. I also, of course, run this entity called NASSCOM Foundation, which implements the Prime Minister's National Digital Literacy Mission. The goal there is that at least one member of every family in the country, don't forget there are, as Prime Minister keeps saying, 1.25 crore people, which means that we have at an average 220 million or 22 crore families in this country. And the goal is that within the next 5 years, at least one member of every family should be digitally literate. Doesn't mean using computers. It probably means the ability to give a missed call. enough use of phones to just communicate. If you're a farmer's son, check on your phone where the seeds are available cheaper. If you're a fisherman's son, do you know how to check that, you know, when the high tide is and your father shouldn't go? That kind of enabling digital India to happen through inclusive. So these are some of the things we're doing. So why am I telling you all this? That if I look at my own life, and I say, in fact, when I was sitting in Tata Silvai at the age of 16, finishing my 10th, which is what most of your students are, if somebody had said, look, what is your great ambition for life? I would not even have known what to say. I really had no ambition. My ambition really started when I got into engineering and said, maybe I should build a career for myself outside Bihar, forget about anything else. But in my wildest dreams, I would not have imagined that I could be where I am today. And there's nothing to do with pride or influence. It's just to say, look, I mean, today we are in a position of influence where we can change, hopefully, the face of the city through the Pune Smart City Program, which we are trying to do. We can change the face of the country through NASSCOM Foundation and National Digital Literacy. We hope to change the face of the world, because what I do on the Global Board of Social Venture Partners is saying, how can we create paradigms of change? It could emanate from Jagruti Foundation and Nursing Assistance, which I presented in Seattle 2 weeks back and talked about Narendra's work. Or it could be something that is great happening in the inner schools of Harlem in America, which we can bring here and say, how do we transform 440 municipal schools in the city of Pune? So all these are what we call fungible or transportable models. But how do we, as simple human beings, come up with ideas that can make great change happen? I think that is really, to my mind, what value addition is. To complete my own story, I went back 2 months back because I had forgotten about my friend Fantush. He was my school friend, right? I mean, I should have kept in touch with him. Shame on me that in throughout building my career for the last 35 years, I had forgotten Fantush. And my wife told me, saying that, look, I mean, the day you finish or hand over your Zensa responsibility, which was 30th of April, she said, next morning, let's go to Tata Silva and find Fantush. So we went on a mission. Okay, we went there and we went to the village, which I used to wander around. Nothing has changed, unfortunately. 35 years, it's still as backward as it always was. That's the real India, not what you see in Pune. And we went around asking people, ki, Fantush hai kya? So nobody knew Fantush. Well, obviously, Fantush was not his real name. Then we went back to the factory and he said, oh, security guard, uska beta, uska naam to, some funny, nah, Jamuna Prasad Thakur. Said, wow, I never knew my friend Fantush had such a fancy name. Then we went looking for Jamuna Prasad Thakur and we actually found the guy. Okay, we found him and I have these wonderful photographs on Facebook of Fantush and me. And now Fantush, of course, wants to come and live with me in Pune, so I have to figure out what to do with him. But, and I then told people that, look, Fantush, if you look at how his life has not changed, he literally has moved maybe 2 steps from being what he was. Okay, he's still eked out an existence. But the reality, ladies and gentlemen, in this country is there are so many, I mean, people talk about 300 million people below the poverty line. Anytime you say 300 million, your mind fogs. You don't even know how many zeros there are in 300 million. But if you think of Fantush plus another maybe 30 crore people in this country who do not see a better opportunity because nobody told them there is a better option. They don't have the beanstalk that I had because of education and parents, etc., etc. I think that's what it is. So I'd just like to conclude by saying adding value has many dimensions. And we can discuss for the next 4 days and each one of us will find our method of adding value. But never give up. The ability to say that, look, I can make change happen in the city, in the country, in the world, and in my own little family, I think that's what makes it. Let me end with a little story from my favorite philosopher. There's a gentleman called Joel Barker, who is my guru on the whole concept of vision communities and vision. There's this wonderful, wonderful video, it's a 30-minute video that I would encourage any of you to watch. You can download it from YouTube. It's called The Power of Vision. It ends with Joel Barker, the philosopher, walking down a beach in San Francisco, in America. And early morning, when he's walking on the beach, it's still very hazy because the dawn is just coming. He sees an almost like an athlete, and the athlete seems to be dancing. He's actually like going like this, and he's doing this. Joel Barker comes close to him, and he realizes he's not a dancer. He's picking up the starfish. You've seen starfish in the sand. And throwing it in the ocean. And Joel says, young man, what are you doing early in the morning? He says, sir, these starfish will die there on the sand. I'm picking them up and throwing them back into the ocean so that they can live. And Joel Barker asks him, young man, have you seen this beach? There are thousands and tens of thousands of starfish. How can you possibly make a difference? And the young man says, excuse me, sir, picks up another starfish, throws it into the ocean, and he says, I made a difference to that one. And Joel Barker, the philosopher, the poet, goes back and thinks and says, if each one of us can say, I'm adding value, I'm making a difference to one person every week or every month or every year in my life, we will make the world a better place. So thank you very much, and all the best.
We have about 4-5 minutes for any questions in case you have. Anything that you would like to ask Ganesh? Any questions, anybody? Yes, at the last row.
How can we become part of your national digital literacy program? As we all are.
No, that's a great point you're asking. In fact, just to give you a sense, and I didn't mention that, we have set up a foundation in Pune called Pune City Connect. Pune City Connect is, the CEO of that is a very bright young woman called Ruchi Mathur. Ruchi is an IIM Ahmedabad MBA, 20 years experience, who has now given up her, completely dedicated to this cause. And the four things we are running is National Digital Literacy Mission. The second is the one I just mentioned, the Pune City Lighthouse Program, which was inaugurated by Prime Minister yesterday. The third is transformation of the 400 municipal schools, which is actually managed by us along with Thermax and Forbes Marshall. And the fourth is Swachh, which is just bringing the public toilets program to Pune. So all these are four of our initiatives. So you just feel free to, I mean, you can actually Google Pune City Connect and you can write to me. I mean, you can get my email from Naren, or you can, I mean, my email is very simple, it's ganeshn@5fworld.com. Five is numeral five, fworld.com. So write to me and I'll connect you to them. I mean, they're all very busy. They're trying to change the lives of Pune. So you may get a little bit of delay, but feel free. So I'm saying, we are love to look for individual social responsibility, which is what you're talking about. How can you get involved in any of these four missions, or indeed any of the 14 projects of Pune Smart City? I mean, unfortunately, any good initiative in the city first gets mired by politics. Okay? And I'm not questioning everything you read in Times of India. But at the end of the day, we are not concerned with the municipal corporation elections, who becomes the next mayor. It doesn't concern us. What concerns us is what I said earlier. Can I make a difference through digital literacy to 10 families in Pune? Can I take up one school and transform it? Can I, as Naren and what you are all doing, spread out through your movement into multiple schools? So I think that if you're looking for that, all of us are available. And if you cannot reach me, just tell Naren. He knows how to reach me and pull me out, whether it is at 7 in the morning on a Sunday or whenever. So we're all there for you.
Is that Prashant?
Yes.
Ah, okay. Geeta?
As you said that after 2 every day you used to come and be with the children, you and Santosh were together. What was the difference that you took into this life? As you were living same life, might be the difference was in parents. But what other thing that was in you that made you to this life, this level and not the fun?
The question she's asking is that if Fantush and I were in the same school or in the same Seva Kendra as we called it, and he just kind of stayed in the same place and I decided to change my life, what was the reason? I think we all should continue to look for role models in our lives. I mentioned my father. I'll give you one small story and maybe we'll go 2 minutes over, but I'm sure Naren will excuse me. I still remember, you know, one day, and yesterday I was with Prime Minister Modi, but the same thing, I think it was 1964 or 65 or something like that. And Prime Minister Indira Gandhi was visiting Ranchi at that point of time. She was the Prime Minister. And they asked 5 children from our Seva Kendra to stand in front of the Prime Minister and sing songs. I mean, we sang 2 patriotic songs, there were 5 of us. And they really liked it because we were literally standing next to her and then she kind of was very happy. And obviously, when you are very young, you have heroes. Indira Gandhi was a hero for many of us. May not be today, but then it was. And I remember then we went back and my father said that, look, we must get the Prime Minister to visit our little Seva Kendra. So all his friends laughed at him and said, what are you talking about? Prime Minister Indira Gandhi will come and visit your 40 village kids Seva Kendra. He said, no, it happened. Then he discovered that, in fact, we were on this, what is called the Purulia Road, which goes from Ranchi to further east. And we knew that the Prime Minister's cavalcade of 40 cars would pass that road next morning when she was going off. So my father said, you 5 boys who sang to the Prime Minister yesterday wear the same thing. They had these peaked blue caps, yellow shirt and khaki half pant. So, and he said, you stand on the road exactly the way you stood next to the Prime Minister. So we said, okay. And my mother was saying, what are you trying to do? Let him study. He has exams tomorrow. No, let him study. And sure enough, after some time, we saw this first car pass, you know, how the Prime Minister cavalcades moving, ambulance, yay, whoa, da-da-da, all this happening. And on the 40th car then passed by. And my mother was also standing there. My mother said, bus, okay, now let's go, let him go and study. I said, wait. And we were like waiting. 2 minutes later, one car comes back, this glass-tinted ambassador. Prime Minister Indira Gandhi gets out of it and said, aren't you the same children who sang yesterday? And my father said, yes, ma'am. Can you please spend 2 minutes and visit our Seva Kendra? She said, sure. She spent 15 minutes with us. She even drank the milk that we used to drink from these little tin cups. And for us, my God, such things are possible. My father said, if you have conviction, good things will happen. This is like Shah Rukh Khan. This is like Shah Rukh Khan says in that funny movie that, you know, if you want to do something, the whole universe will conspire and make it happen for you. That's where, to answer your question, this is where I live. I said, look, if you are committed, today we have a goal in Social Venture Partners that we want 100 million Indians to get a better livelihood because of us. We have no clue on how we will do. I remember we got Naren into a workshop with us, with McKinsey, about 3 months back. We are meeting in Bangalore next week to discuss kaisa karna hai. But he said, if we want to make it happen, maybe we won't do 100 million, maybe we'll do 80 million. But who knows, maybe we'll do 120 million. As Naren rightly said, if you don't have the ambition, and the ambition is not to make more money, but if the ambition, if you don't have a lofty ambition to do good for a large section of people, what's the point in living? I learned this from my father. Hopefully we are still experimenting as we go along. And as I said, apart from those 300 million, if I can also change the life of my friend Fantosh, the world will be a better place. That's the way I see my life. You know, this is something, a very good question. She's saying that, look, if you have aims in your life, there must have been points in your life when you failed to achieve something. So what kept you going on? This is one thing that is different from a young entrepreneur in Silicon Valley, America. And young on, today, of course, everybody and his brother is setting up a startup. Okay, you know, every day I hear of some 4 new startups coming up in the city of Pune itself. One thing we learn in Silicon Valley is, if you must fail, fail fast. Don't get stuck with this thing of, oh my God, this was my idea, isko kisi tarah se kheench ke successful karna hai. Sometimes you realize that, look, it seemed like a good idea. It didn't work. I mean, I still remember when in Zensar in 2004, we had this fantastic idea of saying that we will create this magic software which will eliminate programming altogether, which means that we will, you know, automate the entire process of system generation, some of your IT guys. And we tried it. I mean, it worked very well for a couple of cases. After some time, we realized that it was too complicated to make it work in countries like Japan. So although we had opened an office in Japan just to focus on this, what we call solution blueprinting, we were either just stuck with it. We said, "Theek hai, it's not working in Japan, shut it off." So to answer your question, you will always find that some phenomenal idea you came up with is not really meeting your expectations. Choosing to say, what should I now invest in and make it successful? What should I very quickly divest and move on to the next thing is important. And I learned this really from my first MD, a gentleman called K.K. Noria, who was in Crompton Greene's managing director. And we were all young people, all in our early 20s when we started our first job. And Mr. Noria used to, and this was Nasik, so he used to come every week because he was the managing director. And we would all be worried saying, oh, last week production itna nahi hua, sales itna nahi hua, etc. We'll all be making our excuses. That when Mr. Noria asks us, why did you fail in this? We have 10 reasons why we failed. Mr. Noria would come and say that, look, there are 40 of you in this room. If any of you want to share a really great success you've seen in the last 2 weeks, tell me. Your failures, I know, let's not discuss. But your successes are worth discussing. So somebody will say, sir, you know, I made this thing happen for the security in this organization. And we would celebrate that. Another thing I learned, that look, if you fail, by all means, everybody will fail. But if you succeed, celebrate that success, replicate that success, make more people understand it. And I think what I heard this morning is exactly that. I mean, Naren has been a very successful trainer, life coach, inspirer. If he can create maybe even 300 of you, and who knows, 30,000 people in this world, he would have made a great difference. So I think the answer to your question is, never be afraid of failure, move on. Keep moving exactly what you guys are doing, and you will make the world a better place.
Anybody less than 25 years old with a question?
They're all less than 25 years
old. Okay, there is the last. That's the last question for the morning.
If you're less than 25 years, you have to have a very big voice also.
So when was the point in your life when you consider any leader?
Leader?
How, when and why? Can you tell the details for
yourself? Is that Shubha?
Yes.
You know, there's an old cliche which says a genius is 99% perspiration and 1% inspiration. So don't wait for that flash of genius to come to you. Okay, as I think Naren rightly said, there is a genius in all of us. The good capability lies in understanding when a flash of inspiration is something you can take to success and when it's not going to work. Okay, which is something that we experience, you know, every time we meet every month in Social Venture Partners. There will always be something we tried, it's not really taking off. I remember one of the first experiments we did was with an outstanding institution which wanted to do work for the visually challenged, but it didn't take off because of various reasons. But Jagruti Sanstha, as I mentioned, is a flash of genius, and it's, and the genius is being converted not by the inspiration of saying, let's help Jaya Kale, who runs that institution, but the perspiration that Naren and Bharti and quite a few other people are putting in is what is converting the genius to reality. So I think there will always be flashes of genius that come to you. Make sure you have the commitment, to use another word that Naren used, to see it through to its logical conclusion and make it successful. Ultimately, you will feel good about yourself if you can look back after maybe 15 years with this movement and point out saying, look, this one I changed his life. This was that golden touch that I did. But create those moments for yourself, enjoy them, look at the reasons for success, enable them to replicate, and as I said earlier, we will make the world a better place. Thank you very much for listening to me, and very happy to ask you.